Well, good morning, Harvest. So good to be with you today on this Memorial Weekend. And it's great to be able to spend time in God's Word. Today, we are wrapping up the book of Colossians. And I don't know how many of you are here at the beginning of it. We started this in January, and now it is what month? Whew, man, time flies when you're in the Word and getting after it. And so this has been a great book for us to spend some time together and hearing what the Lord has for us and growing us closer to Himself. And as I was thinking about this, you have some notes in front of you. And in the introductory comments, I'd love for you to write a couple of words down, just kind of like as we're summarizing, looking back, what are the things that we need to remember in quick fashion. So if someone said, what's the book of Colossians about? You could give them a couple sentences. Here's the overarching themes, and then you can fill in the blank for what it is that the Lord taught you as we have walked through this together. The first word I would write down would be supremacy of Christ. Supremacy of Christ. And that is found in chapters 1 and 2. And isn't it great that we can know that Jesus Christ is the supreme. There is nobody else. He is the one and only. We have the one true living God, the supremacy of Christ. And we got to see that in chapter 1. As Paul prayed for the church of Colossae, he prayed for the people that they would have wisdom and knowledge and spiritual understanding in the way that they direct themselves toward the supremacy of Christ. And then he guided us to understanding the preeminence of Christ and what that means for us, that we could have a relationship with him. We can be reconciled with the supreme. What a blessing that is. What an honor that is. What, it's amazing that we get that. And in chapters 2, you found this, that we are made alive in Christ. And when we accept Jesus Christ, our Savior, we are made alive in Christ and our identity changes. You know, if you look at the back of jerseys, it usually has a name and you're known by your name. But this chapter really tried to get us even deeper and to help us to understand that when we become a Christian, that is our identity. Our identity is Jesus. And when someone asks you, hey, who are you? I'm a follower of Jesus Christ. And we shouldn't be ashamed of that for a minute. That's our identity. And that gives us an opportunity to proclaim this preeminence of Christ and the reconciliation story that we have, much like Sebastian did for all of us in his baptism for us this day. So chapters 3 and 4 really highlight submitting to Christ. And as we opened up chapter 3, it was putting our mind on things above, not on earthly things, setting our minds, being intentional about what's going to catch our thoughts and where our minds are going to find ourselves thinking. And it's on the scriptures. And then to be brought into the Word one more level, to be one more level of intimacy with the Lord, to understand what it means to submit to Him. He said, there are some things you need to put off. There are some things that are going to be easy to creep in, and you need to put these things off, and you need to put these things on to represent who Jesus is, your identity in Him for others to see well. And then He asked us to embrace the different roles that we have. A husband or wife or employer or employee, whatever it is that we have, that we would submit to what the Bible has to say about who we are and whose we are and how we live that way, so that when a world looks at us, they say, wow, that is a follower of Jesus. And then last week, Pastor Dave brought the truth to us that the door might be open for us to present the Word. Lord, open a door for the Word for us. And I don't know how that's gone for you, but I'm praying that the Lord will give you an opportunity to see the open door that you might be able to share the gospel with someone who is in need of that. And today, we're going to look at better together. Better together. Write this statement down. Fulfilling our ministry takes a team. Better together. Fulfilling our ministry takes a team. So how do you illustrate that? Well, I thought, let me show you my cultured side of things. How many of you have been to one of these places before? Anybody been there? Orchestra Hall? Yeah, I've been there once, and so I'm not the most cultured guy in the room, but it's interesting to see how that really helps us understand better together. We're all in this as a team. So I didn't know really what to expect with this. I don't play an instrument. I play Apple Music, all right? But it's interesting what it takes behind the scenes to pull something like this off. When you pull your car into the garage and you get out and you walk into Orchestra Hall and there's someone who greets you there and they take your ticket and they take you down to the seat, and then after they take you to the seat, you look around, you see, man, there's people running these lights and there's people running sound. Then all these people rush the stage in a very cultured fashion. And they sit down and they start, and then you're like, what? I paid money for this? Like, these people sound horrific. And they're all doing what? They're getting prepared for what's going to happen. They're getting prepared for the conductor to come out, and as he stands front and center stage, he pulls the best of them out for the best of the whole in the room. I love the fact that on this day, we are going to take a look at some people who were such an encouragement, such a comfort, such a strength to Paul, and he pulled things out of them, and they ministered back to him. And that's what we get to do together as a church. We're better together. Fulfilling our ministry takes a team. And here's something that did fire me up, and maybe this will help hit you home a little bit more. Take a look at this place. About a year ago, Sherry and I were in San Diego, and we came across this aircraft carrier. I'm like, now that's something I want to go on. And so I remember taking the tour, and I'm like, it doesn't matter how much it costs. I just can't wait to see. And I was so blown away at what it takes, and this being Memorial Day weekend, the people that have served our country and given their lives, so many people on these boats giving of themselves. And we got to meet someone who was on the boat, who served on that boat, and he gave us this tour along with so many other people. And we went into the bottom of the boat, and you could see people who worked in the engine room, and you could see people who worked in the cafeteria, you could see people who worked in mechanical ways, and you could see people who were helping land the planes on the top, and people who were helping planes take off. And then a former commander of the ship greeted us up at a spot where it was that he led the ship. And it was at the very top in this one little room, but from that little room, he could look down and he could know what was going on. He had all these buttons and controls, and he had a headset, and he told us about what it was like to steer that thing, and he said, it takes an amazing amount of people to make this whole thing work well, that we can take this thing out in sea, prepared for battle, defending and on the attack. We are ready, but we work together as a large team. And that's such a great picture for us of what this passage and what this book is really trying to drive home today. Better together, fulfilling our ministry takes a team. Today, this passage, you're like, wow, let's see what's in this for me. And you might have looked at it and said, there's a bunch of names, and you are correct. And sometimes it's tempting when we see a passage like this, like, oh, I'm just going to blaze through this thing. So have you ever been to the Oscars or ever been to the Tonys? Or I know some of our team has been to the Dove Awards. And when you win the award, you come up on the platform and you stand there and you start rattling off all these names. What does your mind do? Mine kind of goes off into another land. And at some point, there's a guy in the back and he turns on this thing. And what happens to the person who's trying to speak anymore? What do they do with them? He knows, man, you're done, you're off, you're out of here. And it's so tempting for us when we get to a passage like this to just go through and say, okay, I've made it through the book and miss what God has for us. And I don't want us to ever be a people like that. The Word of God is God's Word for us. And every word of it is profitable. Every word is inspired. And I had the opportunity this week just to take a look at what's behind some of these names. And so let's go culturally against what is maybe typical for us when the music comes on to like skip over when we come to a passage that has a lot of just names to buzz right through it. And let's read this together. And I would love for us to stand as we read this passage. And every time you see the word faithful or fellow, I want you to say that out loud, because that helps us drive the point home that this is a church is better together as a team than by herself. Tychicus will tell you all about my activities. He's a beloved brother and faithful minister and fellow servant in the Lord. I've sent him to you for this very purpose, that you may know how we are and he may encourage your hearts. And with him, Onesimus, our faithful and beloved brother, who is one of you. They will tell you of everything that has taken place here. Aristarchus, my fellow prisoner, greets you. And Mark, the cousin of Barnabas, concerning whom you have received instructions. If he comes to you, welcome him. And Jesus, who is called Justice, these are the only men of the circumcision among my fellow workers for the kingdom of God. And they have been a comfort to me. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ Jesus, greets you always, struggling on your behalf in his prayers, that you may stand mature, fully assured in all the will of God. For I bear witness that he has worked hard for you and for those in Laodicea and Hierapolis. Luke, the beloved physician, he greets you, as does Demas. Give my greetings to the brothers at Laodicea and Nympha, the church in her house. And when this letter has been read among you, have it also read in the church of the Laodiceans, and see to it that you also read the letter from Laodicea, and say to Archippus, see that you fulfill the ministry that you have received in the Lord. I, Paul, write this greeting with my own hand. Remember my chains. Grace be to you. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for the chance that we have to look at this passage. I pray that you will help us as a people to see who these men were, who were so greatly used of you while they were on this earth. I pray that you will help us to see who we are today and what you have for us, that we might move our church forward in such a way that you would receive honor and glory and praise. That when people look at who we are, they will see a church that loves you and is working together, because we are better together filling our ministry. It takes a team, Lord. And so I'm grateful that we get to open your word to see what it has to say for us today. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. You can have a seat. Well, these are some indispensable friends that Paul mentions here at the end of this book, that we might understand who they were and how they engaged with Paul in his life. But this isn't the first time that we see something like this taking place in the Bible. It's true. We should never do life by ourselves. We should not walk with the Lord just by ourselves. We should do it in community. We should have brothers and sisters in Christ around us, helping us make progress in our walk with the Lord. That's what we get to do. Harvest is a church of small groups. And that's how we can move the ball down the field together. But think about this. Back in the Old Testament, there was a guy, he led the nation of Israel. His name was Moses. And Moses was in a battle. And when he was in this battle, he was instructed to have his arms raised. And when the arms were raised up in the air, what was going on in that battle? Were things good or were things bad? They were winning. And everyone likes to be on a winning team, right? And he had his arms up, and the Lord was blessing, and the Lord was helping that nation defeat those around. But when he became weary, when he became weak, when he became, it was too much for him, what happened to his arms? They started to go down. And what happened to the battle? They started to see that there was defeat coming on their way. And so who came alongside Moses? Were there people? Was there someone just waiting in the wings? There were two guys, Aaron and Hur, and they came alongside Moses, and they were going to do whatever it took, for as long as it took, to, and Moses' arms go back up, and there's Aaron and Hur holding up the arms. And what does God do? He shows victory. He shows progress. He's there. And that's a great reminder for us that we need to have people with us doing this together as a church. That's what we get to do. We get to live for the Lord together. In Proverbs 27:17, it says, iron sharpens iron as one man sharpens another. Another picture of we should never think about doing the Christian life by ourselves. Let's do it together. And you'd find so many more illustrations like this throughout the pages of the Bible of people doing it together. And so that's what we're going to be challenged with today, finding ourselves in this passage to see where we are doing well and to see where we are challenged and to see where we can spur one another on. And I think that's why the writer of Hebrews said, let's consider how we may stimulate one another. Let's not forsake the assembling of ourselves together, because it's a together thing. So let's go after this. And the first point that you want to fill in on your sheet there is faithful servants bring encouragement. Faithful servants, they bring encouragement. The first name that's mentioned here, there's a couple of them in this passage, but the first one is Tychicus. Man, who named that guy, huh? Obviously his mom. But, you know, there's so many of you that represent what Tychicus was to Paul. And as you are listening to who Tychicus was, think about those in our church that are living in a way like he did, that were an encouragement to Paul. And here's what I'd like you to do with it. When a name comes to your mind, I want you to write that down on your sheet. And I want you to go home today, and I want you to text all of these people that come to your mind and say, thank you for being someone who is faithful in serving the Lord. You are such an encouragement to our church. That would be a good application from this passage here today. So Tychicus, he was a close friend. He was a valued helper of Paul. He's mentioned 5 times in the New Testament, every time in an encouraging way. You see him in his Paul's missionary work at Ephesus, and so that's where we believe, and that's where many believe that that is where he found the Lord. Listening to Paul share the gospel, he gave his life to Christ at Ephesus and then continued on with Paul in many different ways. You see him in his Paul's second imprisonment. Tychicus was actually sent to the church of Ephesus with the book of Ephesians. He was sent to the people of Colossae with the letter to the Colossians. And the reason why Paul sent him was because of who he was in his character of the Lord, of his devotion and of his dedication to coming alongside of Paul and being an encouragement to him. And he said, and here's what I want you to do, deliver these things, but send Timothy back because Timothy is such an encouragement to me. How many of you find yourself in that spot, that you are someone who you have been entrusted with something? You are someone who is dedicated and devoted and disciplined, and you are all about doing the things of the Lord. I just want you to know, if you find yourself, you're the one who is like a Tychicus coming alongside others who are ministering and laboring for the Lord, that that is such an encouragement. And if you find yourself, that isn't my natural bent, looking for ways that you might be able to do that in the life of maybe your small group and coming alongside your small group leader or your apprentice, coming alongside maybe a hope group leader and saying, let's do this together. How are ways that I can come alongside and be an encouragement to you? You'll notice in these 5 different passages where Tychicus is mentioned, that Tychicus is not the guy who is looking to be up front and speaking before the people. Not once is he mentioned that way. He's not the guy who wants to be in the limelight, to be the one who's seen. He's the one who is helping come alongside. He is a devoted, faithful, it says right here, a faithful minister and fellow servant. As I think about our church, I'm so encouraged by so many of you who fit into this category. The first person that came to my mind was a guy who that has been serving here in our church in this way, coming alongside the ministry in such a way that has been, I bet you when I say his name, you'll know, I know who that guy is. He's the one who, for 15 years, he and his wife have been outside when a car pulls in. They're the ones with the biggest smile on their face. They're the ones that greet you and try to get you the spot. Charles and Claudette Caldwell. Faithful ministers, right? Amen. You can clap for that. Not ones who want to get up and speak, not ones who want the limelight, but they're looking for ways to support in such a way that there's such an encouragement to our church. I love the fact that that's something that brings them joy. But you know what? They've been doing it for 15 years, and they're looking for how can we get somebody else to take some of this leadership on. They're always looking for ways to involve somebody, and they've just made a handoff to Randy, who's now going to be leading a team. It doesn't mean that they're not going to be doing that anymore, but they're investing into others. That is such an encouragement. How are you, who might be this way, looking to involve others in such a way that other people can be encouraged by your strengths, by your talents, by your abilities? They've done it well. I think of the Koontzes, who have served so faithfully in our newly married ministry for the last 13 years, coming alongside couples that have just joined together, like Heath and Colleen. And you know what? They haven't had a conflict like they are right now because something came up and they're newly married, or they don't know how to communicate their way through this because they've never had to do this before. And it's so great to be able to have a ministry, and these faithful servants have come alongside so many of our young couples, our newly married couples in our church, and given of themselves in devotion and dedication so that others might know, here's how you can make it through these times. Here's an encouragement for you. And they try to bring other people alongside so that the work of the Lord can go forth in such a way that the Lord is encouraged, our church is strengthened. Tychicus brought so much encouragement to Paul. How are we being encouragers to one another? That's what our challenge is before us today. The first thing, faithful servants bring encouragement. Tychicus is our first guy. The second one mentioned right after him is someone who's very different than Tychicus. It's Onesimus. Onesimus, our faithful and beloved brother. And you think, well, I know a story about that man that's a little different than what that appears to be. Well, I want you to know that Onesimus, he had a sinful past. And he left in a bad way. He betrayed his boss and took off and left for Rome, and he was not in a good place. He didn't treat his boss well. And he got to Rome. He's there for a period of time. And guess who he bumps into? Oh, this strong personality named Paul, who's preaching the gospel. And Onesimus gets saved. And here's what happens to Onesimus. He doesn't just get saved and then just attend and hang around Paul. He then, we find out, he is an encouragement to Paul. But I don't want you to miss this. For some of you, you might have walked in here today and say, well, Onesimus, I agree with that first part of it, that I have a sinful past. And I want you to know that you have value when you become a follower of Jesus. And your sinful past is the past. And your value brought to the church is something that is hugely important. I am so thankful that you are here if you have what you would say a sinful past. And I want you to know that we are excited of what God is going to do in your life because you are a new creation in Christ. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. Transformation. If you have the sinful past, know that your value is going to be taken off of, man, this was my past, and it's going to be like, I can serve the Lord in this way and bring great value to the church. Here's a phrase I'd like you to write down next time you're tempted to think that you have no value for the future because of your sinful past. There are defining moments in our life, but they don't have to define who we are or our usefulness for Jesus, who is our Savior. I want you to know that because it's true. I can identify with that. A sinful past. And yet the Lord chose to show me that there is a value that I could have for the church today. And so let's not use that ever as an excuse. Let's look for ways that the Lord can even help us to overcome our past and to look at the value we can bring to the church today in the present and for the future. So I'm so thankful that he included Onesimus in this because he saw what took place in his life, a changed life. Well, number two, present friends bring comfort. Verses 10 and 11. There's a couple guys mentioned here. The first one is Aristarchus. And Aristarchus, he is a guy who became a believer in Thessalonica. He's a companion, a close companion of Paul. He was in that three-year ministry with Paul in Ephesus, and he got to see some pretty troubling things go on in life. He got to see some of the riots. He got to see the mob scenes, and he was actually identified in one of the mob breaking outs as a companion of Paul, someone who was close to Paul, and he actually suffered the consequences of that. Paul and Aristarchus were together in Rome when Paul wrote Colossians. He was a man who came alongside of him. And at the next phrase you see about Aristarchus is that it says that he was his fellow prisoner. So apparently, he was in jail with Paul, but as I looked it up a little bit more, he wasn't there because he had done anything wrong. He was there because he was being a companion to Paul. I'm thinking, why would someone do something like that? He saw Paul was in a very difficult time in his life, and Aristarchus was known as someone who was going to meet somebody in the midst of their dark days and their difficult moments. In the midst of a trial, Aristarchus was the guy. Call on me. Put me in, coach. I'm there for you in the midst of this dark hour that you're in. That's who Aristarchus was. When you look around this room today and you think about people that have gone through difficulty, you and I are on that list. And who is it that came alongside of you when you were going through a trial? Who is it that's come along you when you are in a very dark place and you're like, Lord, I can't see my way in this? I'd love for you to write them a short text today and say thank you. Thank you for the way that you brought me comfort in the midst of a challenging season in my life. And maybe that's not who you are, but it's something that the Lord wants to grow you in. He wants you to grow in this area as people go through trials of many different kinds, that you can be the one, like an Aristarchus who comes alongside of. He was willing to go into the prison cell and actually do part of life together. He was willing to give up what was comfortable for him to be there in some dark times for him. That's commitment. That was convicting for me. How am I modeling that? How am I doing this? How can we do this together better? So that when you're going through a tough time, that someone is there with you. That when you're going through a trial that you're like, I can't see my way, that someone is there with you. That's what the church is about. That's what Paul was experiencing. And that's what we get to do today. So are you in for it?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't want to lose you on this. That's Aristarchus. The next guy we come in contact with is Mark. And his story is very different. We've got Onesimus, who had a sinful past. Mark has got a different story. When he was on the first missionary journey, it was with Paul and Barnabas and John Mark and Silas. They were out on this journey, and they were sharing the gospel, and things got tough. And what do you think John Mark did when things got tough? It says that he deserted them. On the first missionary journey, can you imagine doing some ministry together with somebody and all of a sudden they leave you? How that would make you feel? That's who Mark was. The good news is that isn't what Mark's story is later, and we're going to find out that. But here's what it caused. It caused some division. It caused a rift. It caused a conflict between Paul and Barnabas. And it's like this. Paul and Barnabas were sitting together, and Barnabas is like, hey, I want John Mark to come on the second missionary journey with us. And you can see the conversation. It looks a lot like this. And Paul is telling Barnabas, no chance. No chance are we going to let him come on the second mission. Don't you remember what he did on the first journey? When things got tough, he took off. He's not loyal. He's not dependable. Here's the great news. Barnabas saw something in him, and they went on a journey, and Paul took Silas, and they went on a journey, and the gospel spread forward. But on that day, their backs were to each other. There was division amongst and a rift between and strife around, and you could feel the tension in the room. But God doesn't want it to end that way. And what we'll see later in life is that they're all brought back together. There is reconciliation with all of them. And here's what it says later in Philemon, verse 24. One of his fellow workers again, and he's mentioned by name, is John Mark. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 11, it says, Paul tells Timothy to get Mark and bring him to him because he is useful in ministry to him. You can see how they got reunited, they got restored, there was forgiveness and reconciliation that took place. What a great model for us to see and to believe and to be able to live out, that the Lord might be glorified in that. Think about that. Mark was given a second chance. How many in this room have been given a second chance? I've been given a second chance. There are things that we'd be like, wow, I can't believe that happened in your life. Yes. So thankful the Lord forgives. I'm so thankful the Lord gives us as a church, as a people, a second chance. And we can have such a great impact. Here's how I want us to receive somebody back into our church if this happens. Look what Paul's words were. Welcome him. If Barnabas comes back, and if these guys, welcome him. And what he's saying is don't shun them because of a previous failure. How many of you have walked into a room after there's been some difficulty and you're like, I wonder how they'll receive me? Anybody ever walk in? Just me. Great. Okay. Well, maybe you're here today and you're wondering if my past failures, if I could ever be of use. I wonder if I'll ever have a second chance. I wonder if the Lord could use me again in a way that would bring him glory and honor and good for the church. I want you to know that you can. And John Mark, he was someone that was greatly used of the Lord. And you think about a portion of our Bible, he actually scribed. The gospel of Mark is there. He was given a second chance. He used his second chance with everything he had And we get to see Jesus much more clear because of how he wrote the stories of Jesus Christ and how Jesus ministered to him and how Jesus led him. Second chance. We should be a people who don't shun those who come back, but let's give them a second chance. I think it's really interesting. Barnabas mentioned here is the son of encouragement. He's the one who, when Saul got converted and no one wanted to be by him, he's the one who said, I'll do it. He's the one when there was a problem with somebody else, John Mark, okay, I'll go with him. More Barnabases today in our church. Be a son of encouragement. We can do that. If that's not your natural bent, Lord, give me strength in this. Lord, give me the ability to do this better, because better together, fulfilling our ministry, it takes a team. But we can't be content where we're at. We need to be pushing forward in ways that we can represent Jesus in lots of different areas. Well, maybe you're the Aristarchus, maybe you're the Mark, or maybe you're the last guy mentioned here in this section. Maybe you're Justice. And there's not much else mentioned about him beside this passage here that he's mentioned as someone who brought comfort to Paul. And maybe it's because he was there when Paul was sharing the gospel and he got saved. And maybe that was the greatest comfort that he brought to Paul, was that someone listened to his message and he accepted Jesus as a Savior, and it was such a great comfort. Maybe Justice is someone who, when he saw turmoil, when he saw strife, when he saw opposition, maybe he was someone who stood up for the Lord and spoke out for the Lord, and maybe that was an encouragement to Paul. I don't know what it is, but I know that he's mentioned here that he brought comfort to Paul. Do you know that just you being here today, if you know who Jesus is, someone walked in the doors and said, I'm so grateful to see that person here today because I know they follow Jesus. That is such an encouragement to some. And so the way that you walk in here, the way that you walk into your work, the way that you walk and come alongside others, you might be just a major encouragement and comfort to somebody because you're a fellow believer. There's strength in that. There's power in that. There's comfort in that. And so maybe you walked in here today. I know Jesus. I don't know much more. I haven't involved myself much more. I just want you to know you're an encouragement. You're an encouragement to us that you are here on this Memorial Day weekend listening to the book of Colossians as God speaks through his word to us. And how is it that he's going to propel you forward, that you can even be a greater comfort, a greater encouragement in our church in these days ahead? Well, the third section here, hard-working intercessors bring strength. Hard-working intercessors bring strength. There's only one guy mentioned in this passage in verses 12 and 13, and his name is Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Jesus Christ. But what does he say that he was known for? Don't miss this. Always struggling on your behalf in his prayers. Always struggling on your behalf in his prayers. Epaphras brought strength to Paul because he was such a prayer warrior. He was someone who believed firmly in the power of prayer. Love the fact that that's one of our pillars. This is something that he was doing on a regular basis. When it says struggling, it's the word agonizomai, meaning he agonized over, he poured himself in, he took seriously the opportunity he had to go before the presence of the Lord on behalf of the people. He saw the struggle in someone's life and he would pray for them. He saw the encouragement it was. I'm so thankful for a way that you met them. I know the trial this person is. I'm going to come boldly on behalf of these people. He was someone who knew that God listens to his people and believed that God was going to use his time of prayer to move the church forward. He agonized over prayer. He struggled on behalf of the people. His struggle was in the work of prayer. His struggle was not to pray. Sometimes I find myself in the struggle to pray. But we need to get ourselves up to another new level. We need to be struggling in prayer for the people inside our church. When's the last time that you spent time just bringing people before the Lord and getting on your knees and journaling down what is it that I could be bringing before the Lord for our people of our church. I was so encouraged Friday. There's about 38 men in our church. We met together, and it was just about the talk about prayer. What is it that we could do these next 30 days to be caring for the people of our church and praying for them? And they had a little calendar, and they were writing different things down of different ways that they could be praying for us as a church. I would just encourage you to think about taking up that same challenge. What can I do to be more like an Epaphras who's working hard, intercessing, bringing strength to Paul because of his prayer was so passionate for the people? Epaphras is in prison right now with Paul. He's praying on behalf that God would do a great work in the people of Colossae. Would you join me in praying for each other in this church that we could see God do an incredible work to bring him much glory? I want to encourage you with that. Why? Why would I want to strongly encourage you that way? Look at the next sentence. So that you may stand mature and fully assured, meaning you're fully convinced, you're fully persuaded in all of the will of God. Prayer, having the heart of God, knowing the mind of God, understanding the will of God, that we might align ourselves with him and help people to align themselves with the Lord. That's what we get to do. We get to believe firmly in the power of prayer with everything we have. Join me. Help us to be much more like a church filled with Epaphrases, hardworking intercessors, bringing strength through the power of prayer. Well, the last one, four, shared ministry brings growth. Shared ministry brings growth. Luke, the beloved physician, greets you, as does Demas. Well, Luke, he was a physician. No question that he was someone who was passionate about the Lord, because we know that what he has done in his life had a significant impact on Paul. Shared ministry brings growth. Luke was someone who was about understanding who Jesus was and passionately serving Jesus. And you can imagine Paul, who is an intellectual man, and Luke, who's an intellectual man. I would love to have sat in on some of their conversations and learned from them in such a way that it's amazing to think about what that could be like in our church today. People drawing together, sharing the truths of Scripture that we can experience like what Paul and Luke did, sharing and growing each other. And that was such an encouragement for Paul that this man would come alongside, and he was willing to do something that maybe few others could do. Luke was willing to put aside some of the ways that he could have received wealth and maybe even more honor as being a doctor in a general practice. And he said, but I see the work of the Lord, and I see that Paul has some physical struggles. I see the work that Paul is doing to move the church forward. I'm going to come alongside of him. I'm going to partner with him. I want to grow with him. And he gives of himself, and he's with him on these journeys to the end. And I'm sure that he helped Paul with the physical struggles that he had and ministered to him in a way that only he could do. And there's some of you here today that you have very unique, you have very specialized, you have a gift that maybe someone else doesn't have in this church that you could be using to bring glory and honor to the Lord in a way that he is glorified and our church is better because of it. The challenge is not to sit on the sidelines. The challenge is to think about, are you willing to do that? Are you willing to be sacrificial for the Lord? Because I believe God asks us as a church to be looking for ways that we can see ourselves in the Scripture and then utilize what the Lord has given to us in a great way. Maybe you're somewhat like a Luke, and you could help somebody else in their growth, and you can come alongside of them because you see their passion in ministry, and like, I'm all in. And Luke was someone who was greatly used and I believe really sharpened by Paul. And to think about his day and what he was able to do and how much of our New Testament is there because of who he is. We have the Gospel of Luke. We have the book of Acts. All of this, God's words to us because he had a special gift. He had a special ability. And he came along someone and he fulfilled the ministry and brought growth. Willingness, sacrifice. That's what Luke was about. Demas, at this point, he said, well, man, I know a different part of Demas' story. That's true. But at this point, Demas is a companion of Paul, and he's committed to the work of the Lord. But here's the bad news. 2 Timothy 4:10 says, Demas, in love with this present world, has deserted me and gone to Thessalonica. He started the race. He started it off well, but he didn't finish strong. He walked away. The pull of the world, there were some things that were irresistible to him, so much so that he left the truth. That's hard to hear, but the struggle is real, isn't it? When you take a look through the pages of the Bible, you'll see so many different characters that started well but didn't finish. And so the challenge for us today is, listen, the battle is real, the battle is true, the battle is right in front of us. Satan prowls around like a roaring lion. He's trying to take us down. But when we align with the Lord, when we depend upon the Lord, when we give everything we have to the Lord and let the scriptures saturate our heart, and we're doing life together as a church, a group of people trying to focus our attention on the Lord, God can help us through the most difficult times. Demas did not. And I want you to hear this today. Don't give up. Finish well. May you hear, well done, thou good and faithful servant, at the end. But the pull is real. The struggle is real. It's intense more days than others. Find someone to do life with that you won't give up, that you won't put the Lord aside. Maybe that's why you're here today. It's easier for you to fall victim to. And maybe you're here today because you just need to find someone who you can have come alongside of you to help you not to give up. Maybe you're here today because you know someone that has said, I know someone who's not in a good place. Maybe you're the one that can go rescue that person. That would be an awesome thing to do. Look at Galatians chapter 6, verse 1. Brothers, if anyone who is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual, you should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. Keep watch over yourself, lest you be tempted. Maybe you can go rescue somebody. Maybe you can bring him back to the truth of God's word. Or maybe Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which so easily entangles us, and let us run the race that's set before us. Listen, if you're here today and you get entangled easily, you can get those things thrown off of you, but I'm challenging you to find someone to do it with you. God's word, a partner together, rely on his strength. Great news is this chapter continues on in verses 15 and 16. How great is it that they share the word of God? Hey, listen, when you are done with this book, share it with somebody else. And hey, when the book that was given to Laodicea, which is the book of Ephesians, well, why don't you at Colossae, why don't you read that after you read this letter here? God's word is good, and we should be committed to reading God's word and tucking it away in our life that we might be able to represent him well. The last thing he says is this name called Archippus. We don't know much about him either, but he tells him, fulfill the ministry that you've received from the Lord. Simply put is this, see this target? 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 9 says, make it our aim to please him. I don't know how you came in this room today, but we can all walk out of the room with the same intent. Make it our aim, Lord. Make it my heart's desire. Make it something that I am all about. My aim is to please you. And let's do it together. It's better together. Fulfilling our ministry, it takes a team. I'm so glad that we're here today as a church, trying to represent the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords in a way that he would be glorified, and it's for our good. Let me pray. Father in heaven, so thankful for our church. We've gone through some struggling days, some days of difficult transition, and yet we are here today because we believe that your word is true and right. So thankful that we can go through this book of Colossians and see that these pages were for us, for this day, that we might represent you well, Thank you for calling us to be your ambassadors, your children. And I pray that you would give us strength when we are weak. I pray that you will give us wisdom when we are lacking. I pray that you will give us determination when we feel sluggish. I pray that you will give us perseverance when we feel like we've got nothing else to give. Help us to do this together. We love you. We want you to do a great work in each of our lives. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.